lot, to be bold, but not to be bold in kind of an arrogant sense or a sense of sort of domination or controlling situations, but rather to be bold because of our confidence in the grace that the Holy Spirit will pour out. That was a lot to think about. Let me say that again. To be bold in our confidence in the grace that the Holy Spirit will pour out. Because oftentimes, I think many of us experience this right now, things can seem overwhelming. There's just too much. It all seems like confusing. And for a whole lot of reasons, whether you're in that younger generation or middle-aged or you're sort of getting along in years like I am, you can sort of get overwhelmed by things and say, how is all this going to work out? And it doesn't seem to make sense anymore. And that's exactly what these readings are sort of inspiring us to think about, and they're proposing a response. I'll get to that in a minute. Remember last week we talked about watchfulness, right? To look for opportunities, great and small, in the next conversation, in the next time a person asks you to pray, in the next situation that surfaces that you were not expecting or gave you an opportunity, to be watchful for the fact that that's a graced moment, a holy moment, if you will, a possibility of something better that you could be involved in, to be watchful for those small relationships, small circumstances that you can sort of bring grace to and allow them to be experiences of where God is talking to you. And now once that happens, once we've been watchful, to be bold in our confidence in the grace that the Holy Spirit is going to pour out on us. There's a thing over the years I've had to learn personally to get comfortable with. And that is, I'll give you an example. I can't tell you how many times people pass me on Route 82 when I'm coming down the road here to the church. You know, the speed limit's 35. Some of you have found out the hard way that the speed limit is 35, right? And I do, 35 a little bit more. And people will pass you like you're standing still. Have you had that experience? Maybe you're out on the bypass or on different roads you've driven on where people do the dumbest things and so impatient. And I've learned to say to myself, they're just a better driver than me. They're just a better driver than me. Because then I stay calm, right? I don't really believe they are, but I stay calm. So a couple of years ago, I'm driving with my younger sister. She's in the driver's seat. I'm in the passenger seat. We're going down to see my older sister at the shore, who sometimes watches this live stream. Hi, talking about you. We're going down the shore to see my older sister and her husband, and we're on a back road, and my younger sister's a good driver, and boy, some guy came barreling around her and gave her a cocky look and continued on, and out loud I said, I guess he's just a better driver than you. As you're saying something and you're saying, no, don't say that, stop, but it was already out. And I tried to explain, honestly, I did. I tried to explain, that's not what I meant. That became the longest ride to the shore. Dead silence. She eventually did forgive me. Watchfulness and bold in the opportunities, because they're going to surprise you like the road situations do. Isaiah the prophet, that reading proclaimed so well for us this morning. Isaiah the prophet, it's probably a second Isaiah, an older version of the story, says that maybe there's two of these men who we know as the prophet Isaiah. That's something for the scholars to work out. But this Isaiah who we hear today says to people, comfort. Give comfort to my people, which is nice, right? It's nice to hear about comfort. But if you put it in the context and the setting of the world that the Isaiahs were living in. The first Isaiah, the original writer from earlier in the text, his job was to warn people that their nation was going to be conquered by another country, another king, a more powerful army, and that life was going to be terrible. There was going to be murders and slaughters and people taken off into captivity and people enslaved who stayed. And first Isaiah is warning everybody of that earlier in the book. It's coming. Get ready. Try to change your heart, but it might be too late. And it did come. they were conquered. And it was horrible. And they stayed conquered for quite a long time. But by and by, God's grace heard his people pray. And now this second Isaiah, the one we heard today, he was to proclaim comfort, give comfort to my people in the middle of their struggle. When it was overwhelming and it was too much and they couldn't set themselves free and everything they had been lost, they were hopeless and figured God had given up on them and their country was at an end. And now he proclaims comfort. Comfort. God is coming. Well, how can that be, you know? I mean, they're thinking to themselves, how can that be? It's all too much. There's mountains and there's troubles and there's things we can't overcome. And so he goes on to say, every mountain will be lowered. The crooked roads you can't find your way through, it's too hard. God is going to straighten those out. Those valleys and ravines, very, very deep, impassable, hopeless, God's going to fill them in. Because God's going to do this. Precisely because we can't. See, that's the reason for hope in the gifts of grace that the Holy Spirit will pour out. Exactly when we know that we can't fix it is exactly the time that we become people who ought to proclaim it more boldly, that God is in fact coming to set us free. That God is coming to fill in the valleys and pull down the mountains and make the ways straight. I can't say how that's going to happen. Because you're facing things that maybe are deeply personal or health-wise or financial, maybe in family situations or even in the more global sense of the larger community in the world. We don't know how it's going to work out. But that's the point. If we could figure it out for ourselves, we wouldn't need a Redeemer. We need Jesus because we can't do it for ourselves. And St. Peter, in that second reading, he talks about how it's God's will that we all come to be with him, that God wants us all to have salvation. And the call of repentance is a call of, in many ways, surrender, giving up the idea that we're going to fix it all and solve it all, or somebody else should, and it's their fault if they don't. And it's because it is too much. And God wants what Peter calls righteousness, the right relationship, the right way of understanding who are we and who are we as God's special possession. Boldness. Boldness in our confident proclamation of the Holy Spirit's gift of grace in our midst. In the gospel, as Deacon proclaimed it so well today, the first line is the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. That doesn't sound too hard to hear, right? We're used to hearing that. Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Except when Mark wrote that, and scholars believe he finished writing about the year 70 AD, when Mark wrote that, he was a disciple of St. Peter. He was probably Peter's secretary, sort of writing down a lot of what Peter taught. Peter had been brutally martyred in the year 66 AD. Mark had seen that. He had seen the martyrdom of many Christians, and it was not a good thing. There's too many young children here to talk a lot about what martyrdom looked like in that century, but it was ugly, and it was bloody, and it was horrific to watch. Put that aside for a minute. Mark chooses his words carefully. The word gospel, it really means good news. Comes from a Greek word that actually described a parade called an evangelion, an evangelization, an evangelion. And the evangelion in the Roman Empire was when the emperor, having conquered another country or a powerful general, they would parade to the city of Rome and then into the city of Rome, and they would parade all their slaves that they had captured and wagons full of stuff that they stole. And people would blow trumpets and they'd yell out, good news, good news. Good news, the general won. Good news, the emperor is powerful. Look at another country that he conquered. Good news, emphasizing the power of the emperor, emphasizing the power of the state, that everybody ought to give allegiance to it because he's powerful enough to get you too. And then the very name, Jesus Christ, As you know, Christ is not Jesus' last name that we would, the way we would think of it. It's a title. It means the anointed one. Jesus, the anointed one. Well, the only anointed one allowed in the Roman Empire was the emperor. He was the anointed one of God. He was thought to be divine. They proclaimed him as divine. You had to worship him. Many of the Christians were persecuted because they would not worship the emperor as a god. So Mark says, I have the real good news. I have the evangelion of Jesus, who is the real anointed one, the Son of God. Treasonous statement. You could be put to death for saying it of anybody but the emperor, because historically, Julius Caesar was killed in 44 BC, and after his death, the Roman Senate proclaimed him to be a god. And every emperor after him was the Son of God. And to say that anybody else was the Son of God, you could be killed for saying that. And yet Mark, having watched these martyrdoms, watched the martyrdom of his friend and mentor, boldly says, I'm going to tell you the real good news, not about the emperor, but about Jesus of Nazareth. He's the anointed one. He's the Son of God who has come to set us free. In that one sentence, a treasonous statement, boldly proclaiming his belief in the power of the Holy Spirit's grace in the midst of a persecuted society in a horrible first century. Friends, we're called to live as people who worship the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who believe in the life of the kingdom, not because it's easy. This might be one of the harder times in recent history to be a Christian and a Catholic in the full sense of that. There's lots of criticism. There's lots of ways that increasingly our faith statements and our beliefs go against the grain of the culture. It's not easy being Catholic and Christian on many levels today. But I'm inviting you to be bold in your proclamation of confidence of the gifts that the Holy Spirit will pour out upon us. Confidence in the gifts of grace that the Holy Spirit will pour out upon us. Not because we can solve it for ourselves, but exactly because we can't solve it for ourselves, and we need the Redeemer. We want the Redeemer, and until he comes the second time, we live as he taught us to live. That's what Mark means by the kingdom of God. Live like the people of the kingdom of God, boldly professing your belief in the power of the gifts of the Holy Spirit and grace, the grace of God that can come right now. Few of us are going to be called to do that in dramatic ways. It's more often going to be by in our watchfulness of the next opportunity. Our ability to speak a word of hope. And in a dark world, the light of the people of the kingdom of God is going to shine a long way. Be bold in your confidence in proclaiming the Holy Spirit pouring out gifts of grace in our midst.